evening comes from 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. And before we read our text and hear it preached, I want to go to our Lord and ask He illumine our hearts and minds and we receive that which He has for us. So join me in prayer. Lord God, we do come before You. We thank You and praise You, Lord, that even as You speak through Your Word, we see through the pages of history the fulfillment of Your prophetic utterances. And Lord, we know You reveal Yourself in a mighty way through Your Scriptures. So Lord, we ask You to do so this evening. Help us to see that which You have for us. Help us to have hearts and ears inclined to You, Lord. Enable us to see, Lord, the new life which You give us, that new life that comes through the death and resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, I ask You to be with me, Your servant. Let the words I preach be the words You place in my mouth, the words given, so hearts might be turned to Yourself, Your people might be edified, and Your name glorified. We ask these things in Jesus Christ's most precious name. Amen. So 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. Hear now God's holy, inerrant, and infallible word. Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. For the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. With respect to this, they are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery, and they malign you. But they will give account to Him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this is why the gospel was preached even to those who are dead, that though judged in the flesh the way people are, they might live in the Spirit the way God does. Do you ever wish you could have a do-over? Do you know kids are playing a game and they mess up and they say, no, wait, I get a do-over. You ever wish you could get a do-over in life? You think about all the mistakes you made, and you think, if only I could do it over, all the bad choices I made, my life would be so much better, so much happier, so much more fulfilled. Well, you realize that sometimes that's not the case at all? A do-over would serve you no good, because sometimes you suffer not because of bad choices, but because you make the right choice and do the right thing. And that's what Peter's telling us this evening. He's showing you how you've given a new life. Christ has given you a new life, and it's one in which you will suffer. Let's see how Peter gets to our point this evening. He develops it this way. First, you should expect to suffer. Second, you suffer for not looking like the world. And third, your suffering shows your salvation. And this brings us to the crux of our message, which is this. Be willing to suffer for Christ because He gave you new life. So first, you should expect to suffer. In our prior section, we saw how Peter encouraged you with His resurrection victory. He said He united you to Himself so that His victory was your victory. And now He's continuing with that thought of being united to Christ. But now He's saying, just as Christ's victory is your victory, so too His suffering is your suffering. Because you're united to Christ, you'll suffer. Peter's making this clear. He's saying, because Christ suffered, you too should expect to suffer. Verse 1, look what he says. Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. This language, the same way of thinking, it's driving home the idea of getting out of your mind that Christ called you to a life of ease and pleasure. I'm sorry to say, but contrary to what Joel Osteen preaches every week, contrary to what the health and wealth gospel guys tell you, you have not been called to a life of fulfillment, a life where you get whatever you want, a life where you'll always be happy, but rather, You've been called to a life of suffering. Peter's telling you that Christ has suffering in store for you. Just as he suffered, so too will you. And this is why you need to arm yourself. Peter's using military language here. The idea of arming yourself is you're in a battle. Think of it this way. You're in the battle of your life, or better yet, a battle for your life. A battle for the state of your soul. And it comes in the midst of your suffering. And now this can seem discouraging. It can cause you to ask, if following Christ means suffering, then why would I want to do that? Why would anybody want to follow Christ if it means suffering is in their future? Well, Peter gives you the answer. And he says, because it's the new life that Christ gives you that makes your suffering worth it. You suffer because you've been released from the bondage of sin. You realize that? Your suffering is tied in with your being released from the bondage of sin. Verse 1. Peter ends by saying this, for whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. Now he's not talking about sinless perfection here. He's not saying you sin no more, but he's saying sin no longer reigns over your life and no longer has this abiding control over you because you've been released from your slavery to sin. It's no longer your master. So he's saying that when you suffer, you can take great comfort in it if you're suffering for doing the right thing. If your suffering is because you're following Christ and His Word. Because this shows your release from the bondage of sin. And you see this, that you've been released so that you can now live out your new life living for Christ. Verse 2, look what he says. So as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. You're no longer bound to live like you once did, but are free to live in accordance with God's will. Isn't that free? No longer bound to the chains of the past, but you can now live in accordance with God's will. And as you know, God's will is not some secret, mysterious thing that you just don't know. God's will is contained in His Word. He lays it out clearly. This means that you're to live your new life in Christ in accordance with God's Word, even if it means you'll suffer. Think of it like this. You've been united to Christ, and that makes His victory your victory. And we love that, right? We love the idea that we win. But it also means that you need to follow Christ in whatever way He leads you, even when He leads you against the ways of the world. And when that happens, guess what that means? That means you suffer. Because you're standing against the world. You're moving against them. That makes the world your enemy. And if you doubt this, then just go out tomorrow afternoon on a public square and say this. The increase of school shootings is not because of more guns and less safety. It's because of less God and more opposition to prayer in school. Say that publicly and see how the world immediately sees you as their enemy. Sees you as being stirring up anger and hate. And see how you will suffer as a result. You'll suffer because the world will be upset that you don't think like they do. And that brings us to our second point. You suffer for not looking like the world. Peter makes this clear. He's saying your suffering is because you resist the ways of the world. You don't look like the world. See, the world thinks they know what's best. They've got all the wisdom. So they expect you to follow their ways. And when you don't, they're kind of curious. They kind of scratch their head wondering, what is wrong with you? They're shocked when you doubt their wisdom. I mean, we've been figuring stuff out for years, people. We know best. You need to do what we tell you. And when you don't follow them, they attack and they insult you. Again, tell somebody that marriage is between one man and one woman, and homosexuality is sinful and against God's word, and watch how you suffer. Watch how you're attacked. You bigot, you horrible person, you are a hate monger. You're a homophobe. What is wrong with you? You don't think right. Something's wrong with you. That's what you'll hear. You'll suffer because you don't accept the ways of the world, because you reject their wisdom. And why do you do that? Because you've been given a new life. God has changed your views, your way of thinking. And because you're now controlled by God's word and not your passions of the flesh, you suffer simply for not looking like the world. That's Peter's point in verse 4 when he says this. With respect to this, they're surprised when you don't join them in the same flood of debauchery and they malign you. You notice Peter's words there? He says, with respect to this. The this to which he's referring in this statement is the litany of sinful living laid out in verse 3. He speaks of living like the Gentiles live, which means living like an unbeliever. Living their sinful lifestyle, having a picture of a hedonistic, self-fulfilling lifestyle, a life of self-focus and doing what you want, seeking to satisfy your every desire and wish, engaging in things like sensuality and licentiousness, drunken parties like found on college campuses, orgies, which really are describing excessive feasting or partying. I like that translation, excessive feasting or partying, because think about America today. Think how we celebrate everything. Our passions and sins, they're now to be celebrated and not condemned. And how does Peter conclude? With lawless idolatry, which is better translated, disgusting idol worship. It's the idea of worshiping that which ought to be scorned. The idea of lifting up and revering the profane that ought not to be even mentioned in public. And again, think about the current American society. What do you see in the world today? People engaged in drunken celebrations where they celebrate whatever makes them happy. And they want you to join them in their same flood of debauchery. And if not, then they'll malign you, curse you, and seek to remove you from the public square. They'll attack you, insult you, tear you down. And this is important to see, because what Peter's doing here is building on his previous point, what he'd said before, that you don't need to live this way. That's how you used to live. You too were once part of these drunken orgies and sinful living, but that's in your past. That's not your present. That's not your future. And he tells you this because he's telling you this is over for you. You no longer need to live this way. You've been released from that bond. Basically, he's saying this. You've sinned enough. You get that? You've sinned enough. You had your fill, so move on now with righteous living for Christ. Because your sins are behind you. They're part of your past and your old way of life. They no longer control you. They no longer dictate what you do. They no longer mandate the lifestyle that you live. Because you've made a clean break with these things. And that's what he says so clearly, beginning in verse 3. For the time that has passed is sufficient. See, with that language, he's telling you it's past, it's over. You've been free from the bondage of those things. So think about his point here. How you don't need to live like you once did because you've sinned enough. You've had your fill of the old life, but now it's time to move on. So don't be weighed down by your sins of the past because Christ has freed you from them. He's given you a new life, a new existence, one that's lived in his power, in his spirit, in his strength. This means start living your new life. This means give up your old ways. Be willing to give up your old sins and the old sinners that you once knew. Move beyond them. Live your new life with the new family that Christ has called you to. Start suffering for Jesus Christ, who suffered for you. See, we often don't like to leave our old ways behind because it means we have to suffer. We may have to leave family and friends, old communities, old ways of doing things. And that's difficult. That's hard. We don't want to do that. But sometimes it's what you need to do. Because in your new life, you need to make choices. Choices that, quite frankly, your old ways just don't understand. Your old sinners don't understand. The world doesn't understand. You may need to miss little Susie's 6th birthday party on Sunday at noon because you're going to follow Christ's command to worship Him on the Lord's Day. And when you do that, what happens? Aren't you mocked? Aren't you scorned? I mean, poor little Susie. You're not going to be there to celebrate with her or bring her a present just because of some mystical god you want to worship? I don't understand you. How can you do that? What is wrong with you? And what do? So often we say, you're right, let me go back to my old ways. I'll just stop in for one piece of cake. I'll leave church early. Or I'll show up late. It'll be okay. But Peter's saying you don't need to do that. These things and people may be important to you, but you're no longer to be controlled by them. They no longer dictate your choices. Think of it this way. You can say no to them because you've said yes to Jesus Christ. You hear that? You can say no to your old ways because you've said yes to Jesus Christ, who gives you a new life. And you've got a better life that's filled with better things that are designed to draw you closer to Christ and His body. See, the old ways try to draw you away, but Christ, He draws you closer. So be willing to suffer simply because you no longer look like you once did. And know that you don't need to look like the world because yours is a new life. And it's a glorious one, which brings us to our third and final point. Your suffering shows your salvation. After telling you that you'll suffer for doing God's will, following His word, living for Christ, Peter goes on in verses 5 to 6 to show you why it's so easy to do this, how you can endure your suffering. Because he tells you your suffering shows your salvation. He's making the point that because you've been saved, you suffer. So you've been saved out of the world, so you don't look like the world. So you suffer for acting and thinking differently than the world. But you can endure your temporary suffering because you've been saved from God's eternal judgment. Hear that, get that down. You can endure your temporary suffering because you've been saved from God's eternal judgment. You suffer because you no longer follow the passions of your flesh, but rather, you live for Christ.
Chapter 4.
But understand this. Suffering isn't all that flows from your life with Christ. So too does your salvation. See, that's what it's all about. That's what Christ brings you. You've been saved from His judgment because you now live for Christ, even when it causes you to suffer. And this is the reason why you don't want to live like you once did, why you don't want to look like the world, because yours is a better existence. It's better to put your old sinful life behind you, to live out your glorious existence today, thinking about what it leads to tomorrow. Think of it this way. Isn't it better to suffer a little today to avoid eternal suffering tomorrow? That's what Peter's driving home. Verses 5 to 6 say this, "But they will give an account to Him who's ready to judge the living and the dead. For this is why the gospel was preached, even to those who are dead, that though judged in the flesh the way people are, they might live in the Spirit the way God does." Do you see his point here? He's telling you everybody will one day be judged by Jesus Christ, who now sits on the throne awaiting to come back in final judgment. That's what Christ is waiting for. And this is why, even though you may suffer and die, even though you may not have what you want, even though you may be lonely, have bad back, or struggle in this life, you can live out your new life today. Because it's not controlled by your suffering, but rather you look at your suffering through the lens of your salvation. The people in Peter's day, what they were doing was, they were basically arguing that it was no benefit to be a Christian. They failed to recognize that Jesus Christ rose from the dead and guaranteed your eternal future. They were saying, look, you Christians, you die and suffer just like pagans do. So what's the point in being a Christian? Why would you follow Christ if it means it doesn't get you anything in this life? And this had the church thinking. They were thinking to themselves, yeah, you know what? I do still get sick and die. I still have aches and pains. My knees go bad. My back goes out on me. What's the point in following Christ if this is what I have to benefit? If this is what I have to suffer with? What's the benefit of being a Christian? And Peter answers. And they're asking, what's the value of my union to Christ if it means I still suffer and die? Peter answers that question by saying, your benefit is seen on the day of judgment. See, your benefit is not necessarily today, but you know it's secure for tomorrow. You may die in this life, but you'll live forever in the next. Isn't that glorious to hear? You may die in this life, but you'll live forever in the next. That's what it's all about. That is the benefit of suffering for Christ. That's the glory of the gospel, your salvation. That's what makes your suffering all worth it. Just as the writer of Hebrews says in 9:27, it's been appointed to man to die once, and after that comes judgment. So Christ, having suffered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who eagerly await him. See, Christ is coming to bring the glory of your salvation. And Peter right here is building on what he said back in 1 Peter 3, 13-14. It's better to suffer a little today, particularly if you suffer for doing the right thing, because this means you've been saved by Christ. And if you're saved by Christ, then guess what? There's nothing that can harm you. Nothing the world can do to you. They can't harm you because even though they malign you, even if they kill you, you're vindicated on Judgment Day. So don't fear losing your family's love, your friend's friendship, or the world's honor and respect, because you've got a new life in Christ that's got a much brighter future. So willingly suffer, knowing that your suffering shows your salvation. You see, in this life, you'll suffer simply for following God's word and ways. And doing this will put you at odds with the world and probably with people, lots of people who you really love and care about, people who are important to you. And you'll be tempted to return to your old ways, to go back to your old stomping grounds and reminisce about the good old days, basking in the sin, how much fun it was. But these days are gone. They're in your past. They're no longer part of your life. You don't need to live for them anymore. This means you need to be looking ahead to your future. That's what should guide your days. Not your pain and suffering, not your struggles and hardships. Yeah, they're real, they're genuine, but understand they're temporary. But you have an eternal glory that awaits you. You've got your future, your eternity with your Lord. So that's what you want to look at. Not your present suffering. And you do this, once again, by looking at your pain and suffering through the lens of your salvation. Because when you understand that you're saved by Christ, that makes everything so much better. You live for Christ today so that you'll live with Him tomorrow. Let me say that again so you hear that. You're to live for Christ today so that you'll live with Christ tomorrow. Show your commitment to Christ by truly living out the life that He's called you to, following His word and His ways, even if it means you suffer at the hands of the world. Let me close by telling you the story that Chuck Colson lays out in his book, Loving God. It's the story of Meyer Harris Cohen, AKA Mikey the Mobster. Mikey the Mobster was the LA kingpin of the underworld in 1949. And Mikey had an employee, one of his top guys, Jim Voss. And something happened to Mikey and his organization. Jim Voss got saved. He committed his life to Christ. And so he immediately quit his position with Mikey. And as you can imagine, Mikey the Mobster did not take this well. He was not happy about this conversion he was hearing about. But Jim Voss had really changed. In fact, he sold his car and his house and all his belongings so he could pay back everyone who he had robbed and stolen from. So Mikey was not happy about this. So he sent two goons to Jim Voss's house to whack him. But Jim Voss, being truly changed, you know what he did? He stood on the front step for 45 minutes sharing the gospel. He convicted those who were sent to kill him that they turned around and left him alone. And then what happened to Mikey the Mobster? He wound up going to prison for tax evasion. And when he was released from prison in 1955, who was there waiting for him? Jim Voss, the man he tried to kill. And Jim Voss shared the gospel with him, cared for him, gave him a place to live, got him back on his feet. But a short time later, Mikey the Mobster, he was unwilling to give everything up. He soon was challenged on the idea that one converted to Christianity, one who lives for Christ, lives a new life, no longer living the old way. But unlike Jim Voss, Mikey the Mobster was unwilling to give up everything. He soon returned to his old neighborhood, his old friends, and his old way of life. And once again, when he was challenged that that's not the way you're to live, he retorted, "There are Christian actors, Christian athletes, Christian politicians, so why can't there be Christian gangsters?" In the end, Mikey the Mobster was unwilling to suffer in order to live a new life for Christ. And this shows you the danger of going back to your old ways, going back to your old friends and old family if they pull you away from Christ. Because yours is not an old life, but it's a new life you've been given. So live like one who's been freed from the bondage of sin, even if it means you suffer a little while. Brothers and sisters, hear Peter say, be willing to suffer for Christ because he gave you new life. Let's pray. Lord God, we do come before you. We thank you and praise you, Lord, that you did give us new life. Lord, we no longer need to live as we once did. No longer live confined by our old sin and our old ways, Lord. Lord, help us to recall how we have been changed, how we are new creatures, Lord, those who have been freed from the bondage of sin. And Lord, we know how easy it is to be tempted back, how easy it is to be tempted away from you. Lord, we ask you to protect us from these things. Help us to truly be willing to suffer for your sake, understanding, realizing, and acknowledging that you've given us a new life with a brighter future. Let this guide us all our days, for we ask it in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen.